Not looking.
Okay, it's working.
All right.
Yeah. Hang on, we haven't hit 11 seconds yet.
We haven't had to do that since I moved my
give it a
Audacity
second.
To the other drive.
There you go. Bamba yetu yulie
mbenguni. Hello, I am Warden Wilson Matua of the Three Sheets National Reserve. Whiskey bottles die every day. Three Sheets to the Mouse was created to meet the global challenges of sobriety. It is my job to tell you that only with great debauchery and adult language can you be in harmony with nature. That is why I ask of you, all of you, sin nudes.
Fuck that little pig.
Now that is phenomenal.
I love shaking my booty.
I've never been to the
Edison. I know it sounds sorted, but you'll be rewarded when at last I am given my dues. And in justice deliciously squared, be free food.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 127 of Three Sheets of the Mouse. We're four average guys with love for all things Disney. I'm Scott, and joining me on tonight's show are three guys who always hapa duyani. Mikey.
I have no idea what the hell you just called me. I really don't. But I'm here.
Tim.
Jumbo.
And Adam.
Is that something you have done to you, or is that something you do to somebody else?
I mean, if you do it both ways, it's a hapa duyani e.
The emphasis is on the e.
Yeah.
If you do it wrong, it's e.
If you don't do that, it means something totally different.
Well, we're here to talk to you about some Disney parks, Disney booze, and a little bit of debauchery in between. So sit back, relax, and grab a Lost on Safari, and enjoy the adult side of Disney with Three Sheets of the Mouse.
So we're talking about Animal Kingdom. Disney's Animal Kingdom.
Pseudo Animal Kingdom.
I'm picking up what you're putting down, Scott. The breadcrumbs, okay. I got them.
I'm laying it on pretty thick.
Okay.
I'm about to give you a hapa duyani.
Oh, boy.
Hapa your own duyani, okay? I'm getting really tired of this.
This is not that kind of show.
Well, look, as we acquaint Mikey with the various forms of greeting in Africa. Mikey, what are you drinking?
I've got a little something, a little Isaac Bowman that found at Port Finish. I had to remember if it was port or if it was sherry.
I had some of that in the speakeasy once.
Did you?
Yeah.
Huh.
Haven't seen it since.
Well, you should probably get a new bottle.
Hey, you just said you only had it once, so probably wasn't a full bottle. Maybe somebody sent you a sample of it.
Maybe. It might have been a sample. I don't know where the bottle went.
You never had the bottle.
No, we had a bottle.
You just said you had a sample.
No, I had a bottle. I'm pretty sure I had a bottle.
See, you're not even sure.
He had a sample of the bottle.
He's not even sure. I mean, I'm starting...
I can't trust anything this guy says.
You know, this is getting a little weird. He is a lawyer.
It is a good whiskey. I'm not terribly high on port finished bourbons.
Me neither, Scott.
Me either. The night's still young.
Well, yeah. Night's young. We'll get there.
I was hopped up on the Benadryl last night, though, so I know where you're coming from.
You know, I'm not normally high on port finished bourbons, but this one's really good. It's not overly sweet. Like, I know everyone loves Angel's Envy, but I just think it's very grapey.
I like Angel's Envy.
It's very porty, very sweet.
I don't think it's that sweet. I've had a lot of others that were sweeter than that.
Oh, like the Quinta Rubin from Glenmorangie. That thing is like drinking like cough syrup.
Yeah.
Not a fan of it.
What was it aged in? Manischewitz?
But, no, 12 years in... or no, two years in port barrel finish. So it's aged first in ex-bourbon and then aged 2 years in port barrels. Again, it's fine. It does the job, but it's there's a bottle over there that's still pretty much full.
don't think I've ever had it.
That's a sad, sad story, Scott. Hmm.
So, do you like it, Mikey?
Yes.
Excellent review. Excellent
review. You asked me a fucking question, and I answered the question. Not oh, how do you be like one it, of those you shows. Said,
that's where
like
this
it.
Is going.
Oh, Tim, what's in your glass tonight?
Well, a few weeks ago, we went to the Harrisburg Brewfest, and the New England Mary X Murderers brought us a beer. Well, brought us several beers, but this one is from Allagash Brewing. It's called Interlude. And it's ale aged in red wine barrels with Brettanomyces.
I don't think I've ever had a wine barrel aged ale.
Oh, it is 10.6%.
Ooh, how many of those do you have?
It's a whole wine bottle size. It's a 750 milliliter. So
that's a lot of percents.
Yeah. We'll see how the night goes.
Yeah, that's like 300% according to Scott now.
Well, that's 10%.
That's all the percents.
That's 10% for every 12 ounces. That's a lot of percents.
That's 120%.
Yes.
Yeah. That's a, you know what? Same as mine. So.
It's good. It's very, it's tart. It's really tart.
Is it like, is that like the drying finish of like a red wine?
It's no. Not dry at all.
Not dry at all.
It's very fruity.
It's very sweet. From what I was looking up what these Brettanomyces are, and they're, it's a non-sporing yeast that's found in fruit skins. And they call it the British... What do they call it? The British fungus. Because in the early 1900s, it used to ruin beer. And they would make beer. It would ruin the beer, so they called it the British fungus. But it's in this beer, and it's pretty good, but it's very tart.
Nice, nice.
It's like a bright orange.
Oh yeah, that is pretty bright.
Yeah, that is.
Just make sure there's no poison there, because you never know those axe murders. Yeah,
if there's poison, he's done for, because he's already halfway through his glass.
Well, they had said they wanted to hear my progression through the night drinking this thing, so probably.
Fucking did poison. Okay, it's episode 2 all over again.
If you hear me fall out of the chair, that means they killed me.
Adam, what's in your glass tonight?
I also have a beer from the Merry Axe Murderers. And this one is from...
Shit. We're looking for two new hosts.
Yeah, mine's not half as much alcohol in mine.
Doesn't mean it ain't poisoned.
Nope, it doesn't mean it's not poisoned, but we'll find out.
Oh, inconceivable!
Never get in a land war with Asia, and never face a Sicilian when death is on the line. Oh, great movie.
Yeah. T-Rex, everybody.
Mm-hmm. Rex. So what is this one?
This is from Maine Beer Company, and this is located out of Freeport, Maine. And this is Mean Old Tom. And what this is, it is a stout aged on natural vanilla beans.
Ooh.
And it is super tasty.
That's probably really good.
It is awesome. I love stouts. So this is really nice coffee flavors, a little hint of vanilla. It's a really good beer.
That's excellent. Excellent. I it's getting into kind of that September, October time of the year, which is
August just started. Jeez, slow down.
It's 105 degrees.
It was only 92 here today.
Karen?
I didn't leave the house today.
So it's 72 where Adam is.
Yes.
Actually, we keep it at 70.
But I love stouts. I love a good stout. Coffee stout, vanilla bean stout. Man, that sounds really good.
The only ones I have really a little good. Bit of a problem with sometimes are oatmeal stouts.
Yeah, it tastes like breakfast in a glass.
And it just has that overly thick mouthfeel.
Yeah.
Breakfast beer.
I prefer the coffee stout. Especially the one by Schlafly's.
Is that what you have?
No, I don't have that tonight.
So that's a Schuper beer.
It is a Schuper beer. Tonight I am paying homage to... I'm going to... I think this is a drawback to either episode 13A and B, because I think this is where you guys discovered this. Or this was pre... Oh, wait, no. Or this was... No, because it definitely wasn't episode 34.
Scott, man.
But the Knob Creek Single Barrel Select was discovered by Tim and Adam.
Yes.
When they went to Sanaa at Disney's Animal Kingdom Lodge. So tonight I am drinking Knob Creek Single Barrel Select over a nice, giant, big ice cube. Because it's just a... Even the little bit of ice on it, it is so vanilla-y, so sweet.
Millie vanilla?
Mine's yeah, kind of
girl,
Millie.
You know it's true.
Blame it on the rain.
Oh, yeah. You know what? I finally got Tim on the Three Sheets karaoke.
I didn't really sing that.
No. Neither did they. Oh, boy, I had that one queued up.
How long were you sitting on that one for?
Since 1990.
That one just fell into his lap.
It did. And it wasn't
it
planned
did.
At all.
It gave me one of them habanya banyas or whatever the hell.
Habanya banya? What was it? Yep. Something hop.
So, yeah, I'm drinking some Knob Creek Single Barrel Select. This is the 12 year that I have left over. I still got my 14. You guys got 15. Nice little 15.
Actually, it's 15 in 2 months. So it's a little extra than 15.
Yeah.
I want to open it, but I don't want to open it at the same time.
Yeah. The 14 that Ron sent us a sample of, Ron Lockwood, it was ridiculously good.
Yeah, I had a whole bottle. Well, actually, I had two bottles of that 14.
I still have a bottle of it. I have yet to open it because I need to... that is one I want to have a backup of at least another 14-year-old in order to open that, because everyone around here is like 9, 10, 11, 12. There's not too many above 12 years here, that at least that I've seen.
Yeah, they don't put the actual age statement on that bottle.
Yeah, not until now. Finally, yeah. They do, which is really nice.
Yeah.
Now that's only I noticed that this weekend. It's only on the single barrel select, like the barrel picks from a store. If you get just the single barrel select, that is just the standard. Yeah, that says nine. They don't put the label on it, which is kind of a bummer.
Yeah.
But because that means that. Well, it's nice that you get the store pick. If you want to go get the regular stock one, it's the same price. Go find the store pick.
Yeah, go find the store pick.
So, yep, some Knob Creek 120, inspired by you guys. I want to say it's episode 13. When did you guys stay there?
The first time was for the Star Wars race.
So it was episode 13 A and B, where we talked about our trip report there.
Welcome home, and welcome to Three Sheets of the Mouse Resort Review. Here you'll find all the history, information, and tips you'll need to make your stay at the Walt Disney World Resort Hotels the very best and very boozy.
So tonight we decided to it's time to go back to one of our favorite topics. It's the resort review. Now we haven't done one since the Polynesian a while ago. We did this back on episode 75.
Yeah, I heard it's loud there.
And people snore and fart there.
People do snore
and people fight like mad there.
Look, we have not talked about it since I've been there. That resort was not loud at all. I mean I was up till like 2 in the morning every night and ended up sleeping till 10 or 11 on 2 of the days, and we did not have an issue at all with noise in the hallways.
I never found it noisy.
Toilets were loud, but they're always loud.
That's any hotel.
That's any hotel. And there are all those
plumbing's
like,
back up to each other for simplicity.
And they're all the high flush things.
As opposed to the low flush things.
The fast flush, you know what I mean.
Well, the high pressure flush that, you know, they don't clog.
All the Disney hotels do that now.
I need one of those. I could eat more cheese if I had
more fiber. Would be easier, but high pressure toilet.
You guys can see Mikey's face right now. He's so disappointed that he doesn't have one.
You have no idea.
Hey, bring a wrench to BSB.
Oh God,
we'll get you one.
He's driving home. It doesn't need to fit on his carry-on.
Not driving home.
No, he's not driving home.
Oh. Well, then.
Imagine checking a toilet.
I know this is going to be overweight, but can you
see a toilet coming out of the luggage conveyor belt?
I was going to say, try explaining that to TSA.
And you know what? Marv's going to say, ain't the weirdest thing I've seen come through.
It will probably not be the last toilet they've seen come through, I'm sure, either. Oh,
definitely not. Definitely not. I mean, they do have airports in Kentucky.
Two crickets in a row.
That's two, Scott.
Well, look, we decided to come back to the resort, resort review topic, and so we wanted to talk about a hotel that Tim and Adam have stayed at.
You haven't been there at all?
I've been there. Oh. I've been there. I have not stayed there.
You stayed there several many times.
Yes.
Well, you guys have actually have points there, right?
Nope. No.
You did.
Nope. I'm just really on that 7-month window.
It is a beautiful resort. So we're talking about Disney's Animal Kingdom Lodge. Now, today, originally, the lodge opened on April 16, 2001, with just the what's now known as Jambo House. So that was the very, very first part of the hotel. It's a U-shaped building, well, double U-shaped building, really, because there's kind of this small arc of wings that face the front side near the parking lot, and then the bigger U-shape that faces the savannah.
So my question is it a double U-shape, or is it a W-shape?
It's
more like a C.
It's like a three.
Yeah, it's more like two C's. Three. Yeah. Well, no, that's the Kidani one. The Kidani is more of like a... No, Jambo House is a U, and then it's connected with a lobby, and then there's another U on the opposite side. It's two Utes.
Oh, God.
Okay, I'll give you that one. Okay, that one was good. I'll give you that one.
Foul tip.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm batting one for three. That's an all-star.
As a foul tip, you're still at the plate, sir.
But yeah, so the Animal Kingdom Lodge opened on April 16, 2001. Now the architecture, interior design, and all the landscaping really does create, and you know, back me up on this, guys, probably one of the most immersive atmospheres in all of the hotels.
Oh, I agree.
I mean,
when absolutely. I don't know.
When you step foot on those grounds, you really, it's one of the few resorts, and I'll join that with Wilderness Lodge, where you feel transported away from Florida.
As long as you're on the Savannah side.
Yes.
Parking lot side, you still know you're in Florida.
Oh, yeah, totally. Yeah. You see all those license plates.
Well, it's like the Grand Californian at Disneyland, where that you walk into that and you're in a totally different world than in California.
Yeah, you don't realize that there's a RV park just behind your building.
It's a vacation within a vacation.
Mm-hmm. So, the three hotels we've talked about tonight. Peter Dominic, who is the design team for Wilderness Lodge, Grand California Hotel, and the Animal Kingdom Lodge, really created a splendid masterpiece. Now, Michael Eisner, the CEO at the time when they were doing this, he sat in on some meetings, but essentially this entire resort was spearheaded by Joe Rohde. He was really the lead point man for the Disney company when they were building these hotels, when they were designing this hotel. And Joe Rohde and Peter Dominic really worked hand in hand to create a beautiful lobby, a beautiful hotel that really does transport you into the East African game reserves of like Kenya to really create that feel of being on vacation. So The kind of one guiding principle of the design was to become like, make it like a journey from when you walk into the lobby to the time you get to your room. It was basically a journey on of different African cultures, and you see that in the artwork, the textiles, the cast members there, the entertainment there, because there is some wonderful entertainment that they go out at night and they do kind of these nighttime safaris where you're using the night vision goggles, storytelling by the campfires. It really is an awesome experience with a safari feel to it. Now, one of the great design features of the architecture and the design of the building is that they really try to create a native feel to the resort using natural materials as much as possible. Because again, the entire resort is designed with a thatch roof, but it would be very impractical to do a thatched roof in Florida.
Why?
Especially that size.
Of that size, yes. Because, well, hurricanes, rain, all of these things.
Killer sun.
Yeah, big sun.
I mean, but thatch roof seemed to be a theme in Disney when you think about it.
Oh, they love thatch roofs.
Yeah, I mean,
well, they create
tiki
whimsical.
Bird.
Yeah, it's a whimsical atmosphere.
Isn't Rosencrown have a thatch roof too?
No, the tea caddy has the thatch roof.
Somewhere
they got Disney grass has a on thing the roof for that in Arendelle.
Yeah. Oh, the Seven Dwarfs Mine Train, the Snow White Scottish has a thatch roof.
They used to catch on fire with the fireworks.
Yes, it did. So what they did was they designed materials to create this faux thatch. It was actually made specifically for Disney when they were building this resort. And now the thatch substitute that is also used over at the Kidani Village section of the resort, they have a really beautiful feel to these buildings. They really do. I mean, Tim, Adam, walking up to this resort, what's your impression of the place?
It's my second favorite resort.
I love this resort.
I love the feel.
I'm trying to think. Like, the thing is, you don't really ever get to walk up to a Disney resort when you truly think about it. Like, you're usually driving up and getting dropped off on a bus. So, I mean, you walk in, and it seems like this grand hotel when you first get off the bus. And then you walk through the double doors, and depending on which one you're in, you either have a really huge lobby or a really tiny lobby.
Yes.
And
very similar to Wilderness Lodge. Where
the Grand Floridian.
In Grand Floridian, where the lobby is kind of more intimate. And then they have a birdcage in the Wilderness Lodge one.
It's
not filled with anything.
I just want to say this is where the biggest disconnect was for me, though. Because the kind of, when you walk into the one in Kidani, it kind of seems like a Motel 8 kind of situation a little bit.
It's very enclosed.
Yes. Yeah, so it was a weird, like, for a few minutes, I'm like, oh, what did I do kind of situation. But because when you're used to walking into the main house, Jambo House, it's big with wide open spaces and all this grand
giant
stuff.
Fireplace. And,
well, they also have that, like, when you walk in there and you look on that back wall, the entire back wall is floor to ceiling windows.
Yeah.
Four or five stories?
Yeah, and you look out onto you can see the savannah from the time you walk in there.
Well, and they have that catwalk bridge that goes from one side of to the other.
Yes, they do.
You don't have any of that at Jambo.
At Kidani.
I mean, at Kidani, yeah. Sorry.
Well, they have something similar to that in Wilderness Lodge. Yes. There's kind of like a bridge that goes across the top. I want to say the fourth floor of the main building, and you don't get that at the DVC ones, but you do get that nice rotunda that's in the middle of there at Wilderness Lodge. You can look down on. It's got all the woodwork and the log cabin features. It looks nice, but this is a beautiful resort. This really is a absolutely splendid resort with incredible artwork. When you walk into that lobby and the Zulu shield inspired light fixtures, the metal railings that kind of line the upper floors of the lobby, and the window details, and that giant African art sculpture in the was it the left corner, the left side of the lobby?
He has a rain dance costume or something.
Right? I thought it was headgear.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a headgear. It's like a rain dance costume. It's like a headgear thing that you put on.
Yep.
It's huge. It's like 8 feet wide by like 16 feet tall.
Yeah.
There's a name for it.
I know we have several pictures of it.
It is the Ebo Igile mask.
I saw Jim Carrey wear that once.
Yes. Bumblebee tuna.
That's
smoky.
Wrong movie.
Oh, I thought you were going When Nature Calls.
No, he went with the mask.
No, I was going literally the mask.
Oh, the mask.
Or, you know, Cuban Pete.
They call
King of the
Cuban
Rumba Beat. Damn it, Scott.
So, yeah. I don't you know, like we talked about the shape of this building, the main building, the Jambo House, is the W-shaped.
Before you go on from the artwork, mm-hmm. there's more artwork spread throughout the resort. So,
oh yeah, we're going over to Kidani because there's a
through the main building.
That whole like
building.
In each elevator bank has artwork.
Yeah, oh yeah,
on
no,
the
there's smaller sections. It's similar to like what they do at Grand Floridian. They have like smaller pieces of artwork throughout the lobby.
No, but this is not necessarily in the lobby. This is just in the hallways by the elevator banks because this is
oh,
one
really?
Of the yeah, yeah. This is one. You have to understand. This is the only resort that's built this way on Walt Disney World property where you cannot go outside of it. Like, you think about Grand Floridian, where you walk from building to building. You think about Poly, where you walk from building to building. Not so much a Contemporary, because it's a giant A-frame.
Well, but unless you're in the garden section.
But you have the garden wing where you walk outside.
Mm-hmm.
Like, every other resort, you're outside for a little bit. This is the only one that's totally enclosed.
Yes.
And this is also the only one that has a parking garage. Not just parking spots, but an actual garage underneath
the
buildings.
Well, Kidani has a garage.
No, they both do.
Yeah, Kidani has the
They both do.
No, Jambo doesn't have one.
I'm almost positive
Kidani
they both do.
Kidani is the only one that has one.
No, the Jambo House has a parking lot. Yeah. And then Kidani, as you
Kidani
go further up, has the actual parking garage. You can park underground underneath the Kidani Village.
Which kind of takes you out of the...
Yeah, because when you go through any parking garage, it's like steel concrete pillars. And yeah,
but there's
it may take you out of it. But
getting back to my original point, there's actual like pieces of African art, like, and you take the time to read them because you're walking forever.
Yeah.
No,
especially if you have the last room, end of the curve.
Yeah, which gets to the shape of Kidani Village, which is basically a 3 shape. Or a W if it's sideways. W turned on its axis.
Or upside down McDonald's arches.
Yep, that too.
McDowell's arches.
Or an upside down M.
McDowell's, yes.
So yeah, it's basically this, the Kidani Village section. You start in the middle, you check in the middle, and then you can walk a long way if you're at the end of it. Of either end of the two wings, because basically there's two U-shaped wings connecting to the lobby in the middle, and it's a big resort.
Same thing with Jambo though. Jambo's a nice, you can walk forever to those rooms too.
I mean, I'd say from tip to tip, it basically, if you go a 360 degree circle, it's probably 290 degrees from like one end to the other. There's a very small section in the middle of the Jambo House that is open, and it's almost a complete circle.
And Scott Math, just go with it.
No, it's a pretty it's deceiving how big that space
is.
That there, because it looks like a complete circle from a lot of the maps, it's nowhere near it. Because if you stay at Kidani, you can see how actual humongous that open space is.
Well, yeah, but I'm saying the walk from one end of Jambo House and to go all the way around to the other.
Why
is
would you
quite,
do that?
Well, I'm just saying, it's a big resort.
That's
insane. Sounds like a relaxing afternoon to me.
No. It is the worst feeling ever when you get back to that resort sometimes. I am not going to lie to you. I'm pretty sure Brent and Sydney can swear to this as well. Mm-hmm. But especially after running a race... really not a lot of fun. There's no shortcut. Yeah. You can't cut across like a parking lot or grass.
No, there's no shortcut there.
You have to walk it.
I've never been to Kidani Village yet. We want to stay there. We were supposed to stay there this trip, but we ended up getting a one bedroom at Saratoga.
It's similar.
Similar.
Oh, yeah, it's exactly the same.
It's got walls,
zebras.
Yeah.
There's some wildlife.
Equines.
You help yourself to the Glen Cairns.
Flamingos. Now,
allegedly.
Now, the rooms at Animal Kingdom, they're pretty standard. They're at the Jambo House, there's mostly studios. There's a couple of one bedrooms and a couple of two bedrooms at Jambo House. Not too many, but there's a couple. But Jambo House is mostly studios. Over at Kidani Village, there's a good mix of the studios, one bedrooms, and two bedrooms, because that is more geared towards the DVC resort. Now, there are some club-level rooms at Animal Kingdom. One is the Kilimanjaro Club over at the Jambo House. Now, have you guys ever been into the...
That's the only one.
Is it the only one?
Yeah.
I thought Kidani doesn't have one?
No. Kidani does not have one.
Jambo. It's on the same floor where that bridge is, because you can walk across the bridge and look into the...
The club level, yeah. Club. Now, it's pretty cool.
Because you have to take a special elevator to get to the club level. You can't get up there. You can see it. It's one
you
level.
You can see it, yeah.
It's one level under, I want to say.
Now, like I was saying, the rooms at Animal Kingdom Lodge are kind of decorated in this... again, the trouble with creating these rooms is you're taking Western furniture and theming it to East African themes. So it's kind of cool. They do have the mosquito netting above your bed. Does it actually pull out? No.
It didn't. They don't have it in the DVC rooms.
Oh, they do it in the Jumbo House.
Not in the DVC rooms.
They got better pest control in the DVC rooms.
They did not have that in the DVC rooms at Jumbo House.
Oh, weird.
Because we stayed in both buildings.
I would have remembered that.
A value DVC room at Jumbo.
Yeah, there's basically like a scrim behind the headboard. And it's supposed to look like mosquito netting.
Well, keep in mind also that those rooms are currently being redone, yes, so they may take them out. So.
Currently, they are under refurbishment until fall of 2019. I think they're supposed to finish like November.
I don't know.
We can ask an insider.
That's what I read.
Find out for sure.
Yeah. So, beautiful rooms, but the really cool feature of Jambo House and of Kidani Village is the savanna. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later.
It was three.
Okay.
I believe those are called savannum.
Savannae.
Oh, savannae.
Savannasuses.
Okay. So, look, as we venture off from the safaris, let's talk about some of the amenities, some of the cool things to do at Animal Kingdom Lodge.
You could stay in your room.
You could. Because the nice thing is, you don't need to leave your room to have fun. If you have
My God, this is getting worse. This has to stop.
But if you do want to leave your room to have some fun, Scott,
yes.
Because, man, God bless. Animal Kingdom Lodge has got two pools for their guests, and they're split between both the different buildings, Jambo and Kidani. So at the Jambo House, which is mostly the non-DVC guests, they've got access to the... I'm going to butcher this because I'm from not Africa. Utsima Springs Pool.
You got it.
Which, every time I look at it, I want to call it Yzma.
Yep, same here.
Yes.
Every single time.
Wrong movie, Kronk.
Right, well, they both got slides. So, the word Utsima is Swahili, as most things are apparently at the Animal Kingdom Lodge, and it means life and well-being. So you have this life and well-being springs pool. And it's a big pool. It's 11,000 square feet. It's a freeform design, so it's got lots of natural curves and coves. And, you know, one end of it is going to be zero entry, so it's like you're walking into the water on a beach, you know, with no steps, no ladders to deal with. It's just not like you're getting in the pool at the Y. Okay, this is something a bit higher class. It does have a slide, like I said. It's pretty mild. It's 67 feet long. It's just got a few gentle curves, and then it spits you out into the pool. Overall depth of this pool is about 4 feet 10 inches. So, Scott, you know,
you could tread some water.
Yeah, hey,
you could bob.
I am 5'7 3/8".
So the very tippy top of his head stick out.
The hair will stick out.
That's the Scott math for you.
What's funny is over the weekend.
You grew?
I stood side by side with Adam, and Ethan said I was taller.
Yes, but Ethan, he said you were 78.
He did say 78.
And Adam was 5,
Adam was 5.
Exactly, so.
Well, we know where Scott, the gene for Scott math has been passed on. And will continue for future generations of Faharnies. Let's see here. This you got the slide. The pool's 4'10". The overall theme of the Utsima pool is very much pool-like. There's not a lot going on, guys. I mean, there's not. The landscaping is nice. You got big palm trees, a lot of ground cover, and you get some shade in the cove areas from those trees. The edge of the pool or look like natural stone, and that's really all you got. It's just, it's beige. It's a whole lot of beige. It's a whole lot of beige.
Yeah. Now, look, one of the cool things, Mikey, that I think would have been amazing is when I was looking up the architecture, I actually found original renderings for the pool, and it was supposed to have this giant snake water slide where you would slide out of the snake's mouth.
We already have a creepy clown. I don't think we need a creepy snake.
But I don't know that I like that concept. I mean, how do you get into the snake? That's all I want to know. Through the cloaca, ladies and gentlemen, because that's the business end of a snake.
Wait, seriously? Snakes have cloacas too?
Yep. Yep.
Good to know.
Well, it is if you're looking for one. But beside the pool, thank God there's no snakes, you'll find the cleverly named pool bar called the Utsima Springs Pool Bar.
What?
Yeah, it's...
You don't say.
They spared no expense on this one. It's situated underneath this, thatch roof hut. And it's got a nice, large kind of wraparound bar that has seating on three sides of it. That's nice. They got some TVs inside so you can watch your golf. And it looks like the overhang from that roof does a pretty decent job keeping the sun off of you while you're sitting there at the bar waiting on your drinks. It's also got some patio tables with umbrellas down there so you and, friends can sit down and enjoy your drinks or enjoy your eats-esses. And to be honest, for it, I was actually pretty impressed with the food menu here. It actually wasn't bad.
It looks good. Tim and Adam, have you guys eaten at the pool bar or just gotten drinks there?
No, we've actually never been to Uzima's.
Yeah, we never went made it to Uzima's.
We went to Maji, but not Uzima's Springs.
To get
when
to
we're, in, we're in Jambo House, we're at Victoria Falls. We're not at
Uzima. Oh, I love Victoria Falls.
We'll get Victoria
Falls is awesome.
But if we're in Kidani, we're at Maji.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, the only experience I have with pool bars is I've been to the one at the...
Porter Lanes?
No.
Contemporary.
I've been to the one at, at the Contemporary.
Contemporary?
I've been to the one at, Grandstand. And I never bothered looking at the entrees they offered, but, I mean, damn... They got a bacon cheeseburger. They got some chicken flatbread, a nice chicken salad.
Mikey, Mikey, the bacon cheeseburger has Berber style bacon.
I know. They got the
it's still a Disney cheeseburger, though.
I know.
You know what's right next door to that pool bar?
Yes.
It's Chico.
No, actually, mm-hmm. I don't, but. And they've got chicken nuggets. Scott?
I'm fine with that. Give me some chicken nuggets.
Specialty drinks here are basically the same thing you get at most pool bars, except do other bars have the Sunshine Margarita?
Some of them do, yeah.
Yes.
Some of them do. Yeah. Okay. I mean,
it's probably named something different.
This is basically the standard pool bar menu.
I've had the Banana Cabana many times last year.
Oh, yeah. I've had the Banana Cabana, the Captain's Mai Tai, the Bourbon Breeze, the Coconut, or the Cucumber and Mint Mojito. It's Fojito. Yeah. It's not bad. Yeah. It's actually pretty good.
The Bourbon Breeze is one of my favorites.
Oh, Bourbon Breeze is so good. That is, I think, the most underrated drink on the pool bar menu. Because people think, like, bourbon and pomegranate juice aren't going to go very well together. No, they do go really well together.
Depends on the bourbon, I would assume.
The one at Maji we had was strawberry. It was bourbon and strawberry.
Yes.
They change out the juice on some different ones. I think at Saratoga it's blueberry juice. Froze, I would pass. Andrea had a froze at what's the place over by Wilderness Lodge, Geyser Point. It was okay.
It's froze.
It's froze. Yeah. I mean, look, they take the Meiomi rosé and like freeze it, and then mix it with Tito's vodka. It's okay.
Yeah, and they've also got water and juice. So fuck it.
Oh, yeah, water, juice, Powerade, Mountain Berry Blast, all those good things.
And fuck it. All right, so no.
Let's talk about some of the other things to do at Animal Kingdom, Mikey.
Well, you can go to another pool. The one they got over there at Kidani Village. The appropriately named Samawati Springs, which means sky blue or Tiffany blue.
Oh, like well,
robin's egg blue?
In Swahili.
Sky blue. Tiffany
blue. Like hams?
Like, yeah, okay. Yes, like hams.
And the sky blue waters.
Samawati opened up back in 2009. It is also a zero entry pool, just like the one in Uzima Springs, but it's like small. It's only 4,700 square feet, so it's like less than half the size. But it does have a water slide that is 128 damn feet long.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Mm-hmm. It's a lot more aggressive than the one at Jambo House. It's got more curves and it's got like a corkscrew. So you're actually dropping more elevation on this slide, picking up a little more speed. Then like the other one, you'll find, you know, a couple whirlpools and a kiddie pool, like pretty well all the Disney pool areas have got. But DVC members here can also get into the Uwanja Camp, which is a water playground inspired by animal observation outposts. It is for guests 48 inches and under. So, Scott, you and Ethan can enjoy all three different zones they have together.
After this last trip, Ethan is no longer allowed on any of those water play areas.
But Scott still is.
Yeah, Scott's still allowed to play.
No. Hard pass. That is germ central.
Ah, see? That's a shame.
You can go chlorine?
Yeah, well, there's three.
I'd say you're right, Tim, but a couple of visits to urgent care will change my mind.
I doubt he got that there.
I don't know. He went swimming, and then a day and a half later, he's sick.
He probably got it from the plane. There's more of a chance of you getting it.
Oh, there's 100 billion% more chance getting on the plane nowadays.
Scott Math.
Yeah, I mean, as gross as water parks and all that is, the amount of chlorine that's flowing through that water will kill almost anything.
It should. It really should.
So my guess is, when you usually get sick on vacation or coming home from vacation, usually getting sick from the plane.
The goddamn plane. Fucking sanitize, people. Sanitize.
It's a tube full of germs.
So yeah. Fucking annoying.
And recycled air. Hot.
So this display area, it's got three zones. You've got one called the observation station, which is where kids can climb across a rope bridge, and they got the little wall of rotating animal pictures you can unscramble. Like, you know, I think my park has tic-tac-toe, but these are photos of an animal. That's pretty cool. I liked it. And then you got this little bubbling geyser and a splash pad that they can, you know, stomp around on. And that's for the wee little ones. You're little bit larger ones. You can do this thing called departure zone, which you, it's got a leaky water tower with buckets and Venus fly traps that will squirt water across the park area at the kids as they run by. Kind of cool.
I said, that's pretty cool, actually.
It is. And then they got a thing called base camp, which is kind of a water wars area, where the kids get to use overflowing buckets of water and dump on other kids and then hose the jerks off with water cannons. Going to be honest, I just kind of want to get hammered, climb the rope ladders, and unleash a fire hose of water at a toddler.
That's what I'm calling it.
I think I would have more fun playing here than at the pool.
That pool area, the Samawati pool, is themed a lot better.
It is.
Yeah. Well, it's a lot more shade. It's a lot more
about it.
Uzima seems like it was like almost like an afterthought. Like, oh wait, we need to have a pool here.
Yeah, because it's even outside of the resort area. It's near the parking lot.
Yeah, it is.
Well,
yeah.
It has to be though. Because both pools are actually more towards the parking lot side and out of the resort. When you actually look at the map, because everything in the middle of the resort, where you have where normally the pool would be, where you'd have your pool views, is Savannah.
But in Kidani, you actually have that other wing of the building that kind of encircles around the pool. Whereas in Jambo, it's just out by the sports courts.
Sports ball.
They have a sign that says sports courts.
Yes.
Yeah, in the Jambo House, it's kind of like out of the way. Like if you're staying at one end, like the far north end of Jambo House, you got a long walk to that pool.
Okay. Man. You just have to realize something. If you're not staying dead center in these resorts, everything is out of the way.
Everything's Well, I mean, think of the walk. Say if you're staying at the far, far north end of Kidani, and the walk to the lobby to like Jiko.
Been there, done that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
it's a walk.
Do they have a monorail that transports you around?
They
the
do have no. an internal bus.
They have a shuttle van that goes from Kidani to Jambo.
Good. But you know what?
But we also walked it.
I was going to say, walk it, and then your calories don't count.
Well, it was after dinner, so it kind of made sense.
Yeah.
Now, the Samawati's got a better-named pool bar. It's called the Maji pool bar. I think, Tim and Adam, you said you've been to this one.
Yes.
Maji is Swahili for water, which we don't discuss drinking on this podcast.
What's water? That makes ice for my bourbon, right?
If you want to know about water, go find us over on Three Sheets to the Finish Line. It's all about water there.
Yes, pretty much.
I deleted that fucking plant app.
Fuck you. I almost killed my plant. I've been drinking water like mad to make it come back to life. This thing is fucking going to be the death of me. I'm going to give myself water poisoning from this fucking plant.
I'm
looking at the menu for Maji, and I don't know that I would say it's necessarily better than...
It's about the same, but the atmosphere and the theming of the pool bar makes it better.
It was super quiet when we went.
Yeah. Like, was it?
Well, except for the loud chick from Jersey that was sitting next to us.
Whoa. Yeah, but the bar itself was... It was a quiet, awesome outside pool bar. I mean, which is kind of different for Disney. The pool bar itself is not actually on top of the pool.
Right. It's like you got to walk through this winding path to get over there.
And it's kind of like a different style. It's more of like that clay, like clay adobe style, almost like. It's not as like.
Remember exactly what it was like.
We had a lot of drinks.
A lot of bourbon breezes there.
And the we made friends with the bartender, so you know what happens when that happens.
Yeah. Oh, and when you make friends with Disney bartenders, the drinks get heavier.
All good things.
Talking about friends.
Which he was also from New England somewhere. I forget where he was from.
Almost, like, I would say 75% of Disney cast members lived in New England.
Yeah.
Ish areas. The North Atlantic at some point.
Escape the cold.
Yeah, right. All right, so the Maji Pool Bar, Mikey, what's on the menu there?
Well, they do have a Kenya coffee barbecue sandwich, which sounds kind of nice.
Sounds good.
Spice rub pulled pork on a brioche bun. Caesar salad with some tandoori chicken. A roasted turkey sandwich, I guess. It doesn't say sandwich, but it's got mayonnaise, so I'm going to go sandwich.
Yep, probably.
You got the Berber spiced roast beef melt, patty melt, provolones, cheese, and a hot dog, chili cheese dog, and scented watermelon, which I can't fucking deal with that. Scented watermelon.
It's probably watermelon with like aromatics like onions, red onions, and goat cheese.
Pickled fennel, mint, lime, and fennel pollen.
Yeah.
The hell is that? No, that sounds like something I'd be allergic to.
Why would you do that to watermelon?
No, trust me, this is really good.
The only thing that should be added to watermelon is tequila.
Yeah, I've got family down here in the South that puts salt on it, and I don't even know what that's about.
Oh, no, that's really good.
Salt enhances the sweetness.
No. Yeah.
So
back in April of 17, when we all went to Disney, and we went to Food and Wine, they had this watermelon, feta, and pickled red onions.
Yeah, watermelon salad.
Maybe it was pickled fennel, but it was pickled like onion style thing, and it was really good. And arugula. There's arugula in there too. It was really good. We make it frequently here at the house.
I've also had it with not actual pickled, but pickled cucumber.
Yes.
Not actual pickles, but there's a thing called pickled cucumber where it's not as sour or as like sharp.
Yeah. So yeah, I would eat that.
Well, the alcoholic drinks here look the same. I'm not even going to get into it. It's the same stuff.
Yeah, they're the same. Same standard bar menu.
And they still got water.
And they do all the like, you know, if you've ever been to what the hell's the name of that place? Pop Century or any of the what is it called, the value resorts. They do that kind of party thing at the pools too. I think they all do that, but I'm not
all
sure.
The pools have some sort of like party going on.
They do like the trivia stuff with kids, and of course every evening both of these pools are going to have the damned old movies
that on get the inflatable thrown there screen.
And something and other things that both the Jambo and Kidani share. There, you know, you're both going to find fire pits at each place. You can sit down. You can enjoy some African folk tales that get told around the fire pits. You've got the arcade is at Jambo, and it's called Pumbaa's Fun and Games Arcade. They got one playground. It's called the Hakuna Matata Playground. It's over by the pool at Jambo House, and it's so small.
How hot do you think that playground is?
Oh man, it's like a black rubber base to that. So, and the only shade is actually from the structures. There's just, you know, who wants to be that kid who's sitting on top of the tower looking 25 feet away at the pool and wondering why am I sweating? My huggies off when I could be over there in the little bitty, you know, waiting pool.
Yeah.
Here's something I found out that I thought was interesting when I was looking at this, and Tim and Adam probably already knew this, and probably Scott as well, but, you know, I didn't. They got fucking pool tables.
Yes.
Yeah.
In Kidani.
For most DVC of, members. Most of the DVC rooms
most
have
of the DVC rooms have some sort of pool table.
Yeah, they
Grand
they have
Flow
like a
don't,
community
I'm bummed
hall
out about that.
Area.
The best one happens to be at Saratoga.
It is really cool. Really
the bar
nice.
Is right there.
Yep.
Yeah. That's Anyway, yeah, so it was DVC members. You got the pool table, you got basketball and tennis courts, shuffleboard, and the community room, where they also have, like, arts and crafts and stuff going on for kids, and a lot of cool things there. Oh, Jambo House has the Zahanati Spa, where you can get your massages, and it's also got a fitness center. And if you're at Kidani, then you can go to the Survival of the Fittest Fitness Center to feel the burn.
So, Mikey, you were talking about the pool tables. The DVC Resort does have a really cool community hall there, Donnie's King Library. It's pretty cool.
You can rent DVDs.
Yeah, you can. You can rent DVDs. But it's kind of a nice place to, like, sit out, relax, enjoy a drink, and look at the Savannah while you sit in a rocking chair.
I really think that most any place at this resort was going to be a pretty nice place to sit and enjoy a drink, even if you're just, you know, in the hallways looking at the artwork.
Yeah, that's the thing, is that, like, if you're walking around the grounds of, you know, Saratoga, you could have a nice view of the golf course, which I love. I love looking out over a golf course. It's nice. But looking at animals and giraffes and all the safaris they got going on there.
Because giraffes aren't animals. They're a whole separate category.
They are.
Okay. Welcome to Scott Biology, folks.
Scott Science.
Science, whatever. Fuck you guys. Wait, hold on. Fuck y'all.
Sydney Burke, 2019. All rights reserved.
She's going to trademark that shit.
Mm-hmm. She should.
She definitely should.
Hey, Mikey, put it on t-shirt for her.
I won't.
Nope.
That's all I got, Scott. Moving on. Sorry.
Mikey, yes. Mikey, any other amenities that you got going on here at Animal Kingdom Lodge?
You can wash your clothes.
Oh, and hey, if you can wash, you wash your clothes.
You can watch the laundry. We're not going to get into that because that spawned a whole thing last time at our...
Yes, it did.
That was episode 104. Yeah. It blew our minds that you could watch yourself watch
laundryview.com, I think. I don't remember. I'm not even going to go there. Yeah, I mean, there's other stuff there you can do. Like you said, you got to pay to do that. I wouldn't call it an amenity as much as I would call it an activity.
Well, there are the night vision goggles you can take out. They're free of charge. You just got to sign out for them. You got to be a staying resort guest, obviously. But it is cool to go out there at night and check out the Savannah at night.
It's very green.
But you could also sign up for a nighttime safari tour.
Oh, yeah,
tour.
That's right. They have the safari tour you can do at nighttime. Or dusk, I should say.
Yeah.
I thought they had two. One was at dusk and one was later.
I don't know what the later. I know there's one like right at sunset they do, where you go out in like a Jeep, I think.
It's kind of like one of those same vehicles that they do on the Kilimanjaro.
Yeah. You go out in a
but
Jeep
instead of the seats being in rows, it's kind of like a U shape on the perimeter of the
like truck. like a hay wagon.
Yeah.
That you do at the fall festivals.
What is it called here? The Starlight Safari, they call it.
And just in case you need to know, if your laundry is in dryer number 14,
go get
in
that
Jambo
shit.
House on the second floor, it's been idle for quite a bit. You go might want to pick that up.
Scott, they have 8:30 and 10 o'clock. They do the safaris.
Okay, 8:30 and 10 o'clock. Yeah. Mikey, this is the brilliance that we found out about laundryview.com.
So I should make a laundryview.com shirt.
Dryer number two, get your shit together.
Pick up your panties.
Yeah. Yeah, the Starlight Safari Tour does look really cool. You get night vision goggles. You go out there, you check it out. It's pretty awesome.
It's expensive, though, isn't it?
$75 a person. Yep.
It's $75 a person.
And is that the one you have to be staying there for?
It doesn't say.
No,
that you
it
have
says
to be
for
there.
Reservations. Call.
Okay.
Yeah. So
it's exclusive to guests 8 and over. So
yeah, general public can do it. So if you find yourself at...
hey, you all stars.
Well, if you find yourself at Jico for dinner, dinner's at 8, why not go on a safari and see what you ate at 10?
Pretty sure they don't cook or serve those animals.
They should.
I was today years old that I found out wildebeest does not have an A in it.
Does not have what?
An A.
An A. It's an E.
No, there's an E.
It's two E's.
Beast?
Wildebeest.
It's two E's.
Since I am a gray bearded one, I could have told you that.
Yeah, I was going to say, Mikey, we have a white bearded wildebeest on our show.
Yeah,
I've never typed it out one time in my life.
It's Arkansas all over again, ain't it?
Yeah, it is. I'm just going to start calling him a fucking yak and be done with it. It's three letters. I can't screw that up.
Mikey, do you know what sound the yak makes?
Yak!
There's your Ace Ventura 2. Yeah. No, lots of fun things to do here, but some of the best things to do here are eat. So let's talk about, let's start with the best buffet. I'm going to go out there on a limb. The best buffet on Disney property. In Boma.
Oh, I thought it was like a Nighttime Park Fair.
No.
That's the best buffet
I'm
on property.
I'm kidding.
Ain't no strawberry soup.
It's so good.
I love the strawberry soup.
It's weird. It's a weird texture and flavor.
But yes, but if you put it on your Mickey waffles,
That's probably that's called delicious.
I love going to a buffet and getting the fresh fruit and stuff like that and putting them on my pancakes or my waffles or my French toast instead of syrup. Oh my
strawberry
god!
Strawberry soup with oatmeal on top is sliced apples.
And then you squirt the whipped cream on top of that.
Nope. I do. Oh. How do you stay so fit?
Naturally beautiful, man.
Because he never sleeps.
I'm a vampire.
Okay, Team Edward.
Drink from me and live forever.
I don't think that's how that works.
No, not really.
No, that was Interview with the Vampire. Brad Pitt, Tom Cruise. Look it up, kids.
Kirsten Dunst. Oh, wait, is that a book?
Yeah, Anne Rice.
Because the movie was kind of bad.
Nah, the movie is terrible. It's terrible.
It was Tom Cruise.
Yeah. Tom Cruise in what, 97? 98?
99? Do I hear 99?
I don't know. Was he fresh off of that whole Days of Thunder gig?
Oh, so it might have been like 94.
I know, but I can't believe we're getting sidetracked by this.
I know.
Interview with a Vampire.
I love those books, though. There's some really good books. Some really bad ones, too.
Yeah. So, Boma. Boma, Tim. Let's talk about Boma.
They have zebra domes and jungle juice.
That's it. Honest to God, that's actually it. Because
there's more to it than that. There's more to it than that because...
No, I'm just for me. I'm a simple man.
No, this...
And if you go there for dinner and your name is Tim, what do you eat?
Meatballs chicken. And macaroni and cheese.
So this is one
because
of the...
they cater to everything. I mean, they have stuff for adventurous eaters, and they have stuff for people like me who are not adventurous eaters and just going to have American comfort food.
Yes.
Did you cover anything that had like a brown gravy you could put on top of that?
No, but I did. I do like the bubble tea.
Yeah, the bubble tea is really good.
Yeah, the bubble tea is really good.
I've had that at Tusker. It's probably similar, probably better at Jico, but I've had the bubble tea.
I mean, they have some really good, like, spiced meats, pork ribs, smoked salmon.
Probably the most extensive carving stations.
Yes.
In any buffet on Disney property.
I want to say there's, like, 4 or 5 different, like, meat stations that you can get meats at.
Yeah, because there's the turkey, there's, like, 3 different styles of beef.
The spice, that spice chickens. Strip loin. Oh, God, that's so
but,
good.
I mean, it's not only just the carving station, though, but all the sides that are around that carving station.
Yeah. The couscous, the lentils. Mm-hmm. There's different soups.
Different soups, different stews, different salads. Like, it's one of my favorite buffets.
Non-bread.
Oh, I love non-bread. I would load up non-bread. Probably one of the best dessert stations.
Yeah. Ooh, hummus. They have really good hummus there.
They have cucumber salad. They mm-hmm. have. They just. It's a really great mix of like. If you're, I'm an adventurous eater, so I try a different thing every time I go. At least try yes. to anyway. And not all of it is to my tasting, but at least it's something different that you're not going to get at an everyday buffet.
And that's the beauty of it. You don't get this stuff on a normal menu, and correct. You can go try it. And if you don't like it, Tim,
meatballs and macaroni and cheese.
I am just very proud. This is one of the only times I've ever seen him not eat pizza at a buffet.
No, I don't eat pizza at Disney buffets.
Sometimes you do.
No, Disney pizza is horrible.
Yeah, but sometimes Disney pizza is exactly what you need when you mm-hmm. need it.
Disney Cruise Line pizza at 2 o'clock yeah, in the well, morning.
You know where I'm talking. I'm going at.
Yeah, well, it wasn't as good as you remembered it when you're in Alaska and you're 3 o'clock in the morning and me and Jenna trying to hunt down some Disney pizza. It wasn't that good.
It was awesome when you brought it back to the room, though. I don't know where it came from, and I don't care.
Doesn't
it
matter.
It found it on the way back to the room.
It's what you need at the time you need it.
Yes.
It's like that All-Star pizza. I will fight anyone that says that's not good at 2 a.m.
Okay.
Oh, it's good.
But at 2 a.m. at All-Stars, isn't it that pick-and-go shit that's just sitting there?
No, it's the one that gets delivered to you.
They still do that
at 2
a.m.?
Yeah, they do that till like 2 a.m. or 1:30 in the morning.
I thought they stopped doing it that late.
Well, they might now, but I remember getting there late and having pizza. It's what you need.
Let's get back yes. to Boma, because everybody goes to Boma Buffet for the zebra domes.
Oh, the dessert, not just the zebra domes, the dessert here, the dessert offering is phenomenal.
I ain't taking a shot of this. This is nice whiskey.
I don't throw that word around a lot anymore. And I'll take a drink to this. Between the zebra domes and the coffee tarts, the banana bread pudding.
Oh, the banana bread pudding.
Oh my god. I could eat the shit.
The guava panna cotta.
Oh yes.
Oh yeah.
That sounds nice. That moose thing they got, the African liquor moose. What is that? Oh, it's like coated, it's like white chocolate ganache, dark chocolate ganache, and yep. then a sounds liqueur right. mousse that goes on top of it. It's amazing.
That's what I think of when I think of an African licking a moose.
I knew that was coming. And that's
but if you don't want to go to Boma, you can also get zebra domes in a 4-pack at the Mara.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can. And zebra domes are the best.
Zebra domes are amazing.
They're the best. They're amazing.
Also, are they?
But also, Boma does have a good
selection.
It's
the think of it. You remember? You know those Disney Mickey cakes? The
yeah. No, I mean I know like a Mickey dome.
Yeah, it's a Mickey. It's a tiny mini Mickey dome.
But I mean, what are they?
They're delicious. Who cares? Don't ask questions.
Yeah.
So we'll have to get Mikey some zebra domes somehow.
No, you're not understanding. What type of confectionery do they consist of?
It's almost like a mousse.
It's a mousse.
It's coffee mousse.
It's a little tiny bit of sponge cake at the bottom, followed by mousse, right. yeah. followed by ganache, followed by white chocolate draped over the top of it, followed by dark chocolate drizzled stripes. Over the top of it. Stripes, yeah.
I hope they don't drizzle it the way you drizzle your dark chocolate.
Like this.
You usually get white chocolate when you do that.
I know, but if you're on the BBC...
Oh, Jesus.
What about the British Broadcasting Company?
That's not the BBC he was talking about.
Oh.
Okay.
All right. We've officially earned our X-rated rating for this show.
Oh yeah, this one's bad. In the butt bop.
You know what?
Right up in the bobody.
I don't know where you're putting your bobody. Yeah.
But also, Boma does have a nice selection of African beers and wines that you can get while you're dining. The Black Pearl here is, we've all had it. Well, the three of us have had it.
Mm-hmm.
Black Pearl is amazing.
It's really good. Good.
But I think we've never had Black Pearl at Boma.
No, they do have it though. You do have it at Sanaa, right?
We had it at Sanaa.
Well, we bought it, I want to say. Well, the first time we had a glass.
And then you bought it.
We put the bottle.
Yeah.
At the Mara, right? You can buy it at the Mara.
No,
right?
We bought it at... Because we didn't know they sold it at the Mara.
Okay.
At that point.
No, they don't sell it at the Mara. They sell it at Zawadi.
Okay.
That could be why, too.
But yeah, they also have a jungle juice frozen beverage, which is basically pog juice.
It's pog juice.
Yeah.
Pog juice
is so good. It's so good, though. God dang it, pog juice is just great.
Dude, pog juice is the best because you can literally mix that with either rum or tequila, and it tastes great.
And it
you can mix it with vodka. It's really an all-inclusive juice.
Yeah, but when they bring it by the table, they just fill up your glass, and you're just thinking, no, put that... pitcher down.
You just gotta ask for it.
You just gotta ask, and they will leave you the pitcher.
Ask for a pitcher.
Ask for a pitcher, they'll leave it.
Yeah.
I mean, I won't even use my glass. I need the pitcher and a big ass straw, ma'am.
I think when we've had dinner here, I've only ever done the beer. I've only done the Tusker Lager.
Yeah, I usually do the Safari Amber Ale. I love that one.
Is it anything like the Asante Amber?
I think it's similar. Safari Amber was actually made by Budweiser.
Safari Amber was Sam Adams.
Maybe it is. I knew it was a big beer company or a macrobrew that owns it. And don't get me started on those people that think Sam Adams is a microbrew.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
So, yeah. All right. The other restaurant, just a stone's throw away from Boma, is Jiko. The cooking place.
One of my favorite restaurants.
So need and want and desire and beg.
Have you never been?
No, we've never been.
You have to go.
You have to go.
I know.
It was on our list for reservations on our last trip, and I don't know how it got bumped. I think it was a time constraint, but I was like, no, we have to do this. And then we didn't apparently have to do it because we didn't do it.
The only issue for me is unless you're staying at Animal Kingdom,
it's hard to get
to. It's out of the way.
But you see...
But we've done it. We've done it every trip, and we've stayed everywhere.
We haven't done it every trip. It's like almost every other trip. We've done it a lot. But what you do is, like, there's nothing saying you can't... Everybody carries a backpack or some sort of bag with them through the park when they go to the park. Throw a nice shirt in there. And change in the bathroom, and you're good to go. If you go to Animal Kingdom during the day, end your night there.
Go a few minutes early and have a drink at Victoria Falls.
Exactly.
Which is a half a floor up.
I'm gonna see if I can
half a floor.
Yes.
It's kind of in between the first and second floor. It's
kind of cool.
We'll get to that.
Is that also where you find John Malkovich?
Malkovich?
Maybe, yeah.
You know what? I think on our next trip, I'm going to call ahead because Boma has chicken nuggets.
Well, you can get chicken nuggets.
I'm going to call ahead and see if I can get chicken nuggets because I want to eat here so bad.
Do it.
So bad!
It's one of my most favorite restaurants on property, and Jiko literally means the cooking place.
Mm-hmm. Well, it actually says it underneath. I think that's the full name of the restaurant.
Yeah, the full name is Jiko, the cooking place.
It's a blend of African, Indian, and Mediterranean cuisine. And I've never had a bad meal here.
I mean, they pamper you so much at this restaurant. This is a 5-star dining experience, in my opinion. You walk in, you get seated, they give you the warm towels to wash your hands with, to wipe your hands with. They offer you the mint tea, and they tell you the story about the Moroccan mint tea. And why they serve it, and it's a dining experience. It's not just you sit down, you eat, you go.
Most tables overlook Savannah, but my biggest experience eating here is the wine room.
Oh, dude, that room.
And if you listen, this was a splurge dinner for us. We did this. They happened to seat us in the wine room, and we ordered a bottle of wine, and it's probably one of the best bottles of wine I've ever had in my life. And I just found the picture I took of the label, and I've been trying to find this bottle ever since in the wild, and I can't find it. It's
African wines are so hard to come by.
They are. It's from Bellingham Wineries in South Africa. It's the Bernard Series Small Barrel SMV, which is Shiraz, Mourvedre, and Vineyard grapes. It is amazing. And you order a bottle of wine, and you watch your server go to the wall and just grab it off the wall.
It was awesome.
It was amazing.
Yeah.
You literally surrounded three walls are floor-to-ceiling wine racks.
Yeah. Their wine selection rivals places like Yachtsman. And
thing with, and I have to take that a step further, because these are wines that you're not going to get every place else.
We were told that Gico has the most extensive wine list on property.
They did.
African wine list.
Yeah, African wine list. I mean, California Grill has, I think, like 250 bottles. But those are all California wines that you and I can get on a regular basis.
Exactly. And a lot less expensive. This is something you're not going to get anywhere else.
No. And again, look, I love wine. Tim and Adam have a wine fridge. I have a wine fridge. We understand that there, like, our liquor stores maybe carry 10, 15 bottles of African wines.
And it's Jam Jar.
Jam Jar, Ernie L's, David Frost. Ernie L's,
yeah.
Goats Do Roam, which is overly sweet. I don't like that one.
Oh, I don't like it at all either.
It's terrible.
And it's a play on Côtes du Rhône.
Yeah, I know. It's not good.
It's not good at all.
The Black Pearl. There are a few stores in our area that do carry it. That is a good wine.
Yeah, I've tried to find it many times on my voyages, not here in Arkansas, but when I was in Houston. I figured that'd be my best bet.
The ShopRite in Mount Pocono sometimes has it, so it's if I can grab a couple bottles before
it's hit or miss.
BSB will bring you some down. It's hit or miss.
Tim, the only place I know of it is the Fort Lee one over by Linwood Plaza. Gico is on my radar, mostly because the grilled wild boar tenderloin appetizer.
That's one of Adam's favorites.
It's so fucking good. It just is amazing.
Looks so awesome.
It's amazing. The food there is amazing. And if you're an adventurous eater, they have some wild game that you are not going to get prepared any place else.
And they rotate the wild game.
Yes.
Because they've had elk at one time.
Yes.
See, that's what I'm down for, is all that stuff. Again, the wild boar, the elk, the bison. Generally wild game anymore because they farm them, but still. Yes. All of them.
Now, they do have, if you're not, like, for Andrew would definitely get the oak-grilled filet mignon.
Me too. And it's one of the best prepared filets on property.
Everyone says that. Like, it's a standard filet, and there are plenty of places that do the and I'm going to put this in air quotes, Wagyu filet. But I think time and time again, this is rated one of the best steaks on property.
Well, it's the accoutrements that come with that.
Oh, yes, there are.
The olive oil potatoes
are
amazing.
And that red wine
I don't
wine
know
sauce.
Exactly what African red wine they use for their sauce, but it's so good.
Yeah. But
then I got, the last time we were there, I got the babotti macaroni and cheese. As a kind of like a little extra.
For a while, they used to do the truffle mac and cheese.
I don't remember them ever doing the truffle mac and
cheese. We didn't go when they were doing truffle mac and cheese.
Yeah, it was a while ago. I mean, they do have some other African style, like the puri puri chicken. Has anyone had puri puri anything?
I don't eat chicken out.
I know. But have you ever had puri puri anything?
I want to say I've had... might have been vegetables.
I made puri puri shrimp one time. I love spicy things. This was one of the spiciest things I've ever eaten.
That's puri puri. Something coming from you, Scott.
Well, puri puri is ghost pepper.
Okay.
I know I've had puri puri and things. I just don't remember exactly.
It's
what
spicy. If you like spicy things, it's really good.
But the flavor profiles here are extremely on point. So yeah. it nothing overpowers anything else.
Adam, have you had the lamb shank here?
Yes. Because there was one trip where all I ate was lamb. There was another trip where all I ate was duck.
That was the 17th trip.
May.
Yeah. The May episode 13. Yeah. It was lamb all day.
Lamb everything.
It's just, I have themes when I go to Disney, it seems, and it's usually around food. So.
Yeah. So they do have a prefix menu, which they have an oak-grilled bone-in ribeye. Adam, tell me this would happen.
I would eat it, but there's some, again, I can get a ribeye anywhere, and I'm not.
I know.
It's not something that I would go to some place like this. I know.
You and I would get the lamb and the boar and something exotic.
I mean, this is my time to try something and get a little bit more adventurous. Where I can get a ribeye. I can get a bone-in ribeye. I can get the tomahawk steak, which is awesome. Which is what I'm probably going to get for my birthday.
Yeah, you can get the Egyptian kushari,
which I might get for my birthday. When we go out to dinner.
It looks really good. I definitely want to try this. And if they're near Boma, I'm sure they can get you some chicken nuggets from Boma.
They seem to be more accommodating at this restaurant than any of the Disney restaurants I've ever been to.
I will say, I think the resorts are more accommodating than the parks because they have a little more leeway with all of the kitchens that they have available.
But I don't see it from I can't see it happening at California Grill.
No, I'll say California Grill was pretty accommodating. They did accommodate Ethan's eating habits, which were atrocious. Still are. They're pretty good. California Grill is pretty good. Flying Fish was tough only because they're a separate kitchen from everywhere else.
Yeah.
Boardwalk is really tough because, again,
everything's separate.
Each of those restaurants at Boardwalk, it's not like. I would hazard a guess to say that Jiko and Boma share a kitchen.
No. They don't.
Oh, wait, no. They're, Jiko
Boma's
is
Boma's kitchen is completely open.
Yeah.
And so is Jiko's, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of. They both have their own kitchen. You can see into both kitchens.
But they're walking distance to each other.
Yes.
And they're all owned by the same company. Flying Fish, Trattoria, Toscana, and all of the ESPN and big, I always forget the name of this, Big City River Grill
Brewing thing. Works.
Yeah, whatever it is. They're all separately maintained, very closed off. So I definitely feel like Jiko could accommodate that. And I totally want to try this place. I want to try the bone marrow. I'm looking at the menu right now, the fire roasted bone marrow.
Definitely recommended to try this place.
Oh, God. Probably really good. All right, so as we get on, there are some other restaurants now over at the Kidani Village. There is what is highly rated. Again, all of the restaurants here are highly rated throughout Disney property. Sanaa rates one of the best Disney restaurants on property,
without a doubt. And I mean, another thing that's not talked about so much, but it's still attached to Sanaa, is Sanaa Lounge.
Yes.
There is a lounge.
Let's start there.
It's not a huge lounge. It's very limited seating, and it's first come, first serve, like most Disney lounges are. But this is where we first had, Tim first had the bourbon flight.
Which had the Knob Creek Select.
Yes, so everything comes full circle. This is where Tim first had the Knob. We had the
I had my first heart attack when I asked to buy a bottle, and they told me how much it was. Yes.
What was the price on that? Like $350?
$300.
Yes.
For a $50 bottle.
The question is, did you think about it, or did you just immediately go, no?
No, I thought about it.
Okay. No, I went, no.
As a matter of fact. And then later you realized, all you have to do is just be the last one to get the bit end of the box.
Not always. Because we tried it again once before and we were denied. But I do have an empty bottle that I got from Top of the World.
They do have some specialty drinks. They have an African Star Mojito.
Oh, this is the only place you can get this, right?
I'm not too sure if you can get it at other bars or not. But it's possible. I didn't look into where else you can get it.
I think this is like a specialty to either Animal Kingdom. No, it's only at Sanaa. That's right.
Oh, right.
It's only at Sanaa.
So this has Star African Rum, Vanderhum Tangerine Liqueur from South Africa, fresh mint and lime.
Now the Vanderhum is used in a bunch of different drinks at
yes.
either Animal Kingdom or Animal Kingdom Lodge. But the Star African Rum is the this drink is only available at Sanaa.
There you go. We have a candy coconut cooler, which again is the Star African Rum coconut vanilla ice cream and orange juice. So it sounds like a creamsicle to me.
Yeah, that's basically a creamsicle in a glass, and probably really, really delicious on a hot day.
And sounds we really also sweet. Have the Malawi Mango Margarita, which is a another frozen cocktail with tequila, Vanderhum tangerine liqueur, mango puree, and freshly squeezed lime juice.
Still sounds delicious.
It does sound awesome, but this is where I'm going to interest Scott really bad.
Lay it on me, baby.
They have Discovery Wine Flights.
Yeah. You know me. I love a flight.
And these are all based on African regions. So we have a wine flight from Durban. We have a wine flight from, actually, Sanaa. We have a wine flight from East London, Johannesburg, and Kidani.
J-Berg, baby.
And these all have different kinds of blends. And, I mean, I could sit here and go through each one, but I'm not. Prices range for the wine flights from $15 to $19 for the most expensive one, which is not
awful. That sounds pretty decent.
And you're getting, I think, was it like 1 ounce or 1 ounce and a quarter per glass?
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a decent looking. We saw somebody get one, and they're decent sized pours.
All right. I actually think it's 3 2-ounce pours. So you're getting, normally a glass at Disney is going to run about 5 ounces. They have, some of the lounges have a little star on their glasses that tell them when to stop pouring, so you don't get too much, and it's a 5 ounce glass of wine. These are generally 3 2-ounce pours, and they pour them in the same glass. So sometimes, again, if you've chatted up the bartender, if you've gotten to know them over the course of your vacation, maybe you get a little bit more. And maybe that bottle is on the last way out and you get the rest of it.
You never know. It can hurt to try it.
Yeah. And again, the Discovery Wine Flights over at Sanaa are ridiculous. They're really
good. And again, the only problem is these are ones that you're not going to be able to easily get.
No. A couple of them feature African wines mixed with domestic wines. Like, there's the Lassiter family wine in the Durban flight. The McMurray Ranch is a California wine. But for the most part, these are all African wines.
I mean, maybe next time. There's always a next time.
Yeah. Yeah. Trust me, they're good.
All right. And then, of course, the restaurant itself actually overlooks the Sunset Savannah. And there's a bunch of spots where you can get really up close and close to those windows. Breakfast is served there from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. And it's a quick service menu. So you're going to have your standard quick service fare. But you can also get things like the Bobotie pie there, which is what I ate for breakfast every morning, pretty much.
It's got sausage and
Why
egg.
Not?
It's
okay.
It was just so good, and it wasn't expensive at all. I'd grab my coffee, grab the food, and we would be on our way. I didn't really go into the lunch menu too much, but lunch and dinner are sit-down.
Lunch?
So,
have you guys ever been here for lunch?
No, we've only done dinner.
If you go for lunch, it's definitely a more intimate experience. There's not a lot of people there for lunch.
Yeah, I've never, but we've gone there for dinner. And dinner gets
They do have a lunch. Dinner is more. Dinner is way more crowded.
Yes. And the star of this, which everybody raves about if they've ever had it, is the Indian style bread service.
Yeah, everybody loves it. And Tim won't share it.
No, we shared this because there's a lot. There's
Tim, you shared?
You get a lot. Yeah, you get a lot.
You get a lot. I want to say, how many is it? Was it 15 dipping sauces?
It's 5 breads and 9 sauces, but you they get have 4 more or 5 more,
yes,
for like an extra like $3.
And we did that.
And then sometimes, if you're really nice to the server, they'll bring you ones that they no longer make.
Speaking of these appetizers, and I know bread service is really good, braised oxtail.
Yep, that was on my list.
dude, if you've ever had braised oxtail, and I have because we went to our honeymoon in Jamaica, it's really good. There's a Jamaican restaurant down the street from us. It's amazing. Braised oxtail, so
I think don't good. Know if this is going to be the same style as Jamaican oxtail, though.
Well, it's that like it's very much African style, so it's very similar. But braised oxtail is ridiculously good, dude.
And then for your main course, I chose the. I mean, you have your basics. You have a steak dish. What I chose to point out is the
lamb shank.
The Padoje inspired.
Oh yeah, it's like
and
a.
This platter. Is. It's a well. It's not so much a platter, but you actually get to choose one from the journey and one from the harvest. The journey is going to be where you're going to have your meat. So you can have things like this Goan seafood curry, butter chicken, braised beef, paneer tikka, or a spicy Durban shrimp. And from the harvest, which is all your plant-based stuff, so you can have chickpea wat, aloo masala, lentil dal, or cilantro coconut vegetables. And this is all served with basmati rice.
See, and this is where the Indian comes into this. Almost like... More, this is more of a Durban style. So Durban style has very heavily influenced with Indian culture.
But I like this idea because you can almost kind of create your own dish this way and choose what exactly you want to eat or feel like
eating. That's what you got when we ate.
I want to say it is, but I don't remember what I chose.
Yeah. I know I got in the, I can't even pronounce it, South African Brevelies, which is all different meats,
yes.
Different sauces and sides.
The best thing you can do at this place, in my opinion, is to go out of your comfort zone, choose two different entrees if you're two people or two adults, and pick off each other's plate. Because you're never going to get an experience like that in most places.
Paneer tikka, spicy Durban shrimp, the duck, the biryani pots. It's a nice, fragrant, and flavorful combination of both African and Indian cuisine.
Definitely.
If you're afraid, again, there are some people that are afraid of Indian cuisine. This is a good intro to it.
And again, go with somebody adventurous. Go with somebody who's not afraid to try something, and then this way, if you don't like it, at least they make them order it.
Yeah. Hmm. And you can have something safe and get your grilled New York strip steak and you'll enjoy your dinner. But then you can try their paneer tikka, which is like a spinach and tomato based with cottage. Essentially, it's like cheese compacted. It's sauce cheese. It's really
good. I like cheese. I don't care.
You would like it.
You'd like it. It leaves me impacted, but I still like cheese.
Adam or Mikey, if you go to Sanaa, get the paneer tikka.
Yes.
And then for dessert, I have two choices for dessert as well. So you have your African triple chocolate mousse, which is...
I'll have two.
Manjari 64% dark chocolate from Madagascar.
I'll have three.
Javara milk chocolate, Ivoire white chocolate, a chocolate biscuit, and strawberries. And then, of course, because I'm a Banana Foresters person, I chose the Caramel Ndizi, which is banana fancier with caramelized milk chocolate surmux. I don't know how to say that. Hazelnut crunch, banana white chocolate chantilly, and a ginger raspberries.
Let's talk desserts, because I'm not a big dessert guy. I would much rather fill with appetizers and entrees. But Bananas Foster is like...
This is not a Foster so much.
It's not so much, but it is very much like... banana desserts, I go weak in the knees. Like, banoffee pie, love it. Bananas Foster, love it. The banana bread pudding with caramel and vanilla ice cream over at Ohana, I'm all over that.
Oh, yes, that was zero. That's really...
I've only ever had banana pudding. With vanilla wafers.
Oh, dude!
But you know, all the African restaurants, or the African inspired restaurants at Disney, Jiko, Sanaa, Tiffin's, the chocolate desserts there are bar none the top.
The chef,
I'm a sucker for chocolate.
The pastry chefs here rival those of Paris. I'll put it that way, because I've had some of the pastries here. They are really good. The pastry chefs here are some of the best in Walt Disney World, and markedly so. The a couple years ago, I want to say it was like 2012, the pastry chef from Sanaa actually got bumped up to the pastry chef at Victoria and Albert's.
It doesn't surprise me at all.
Mm. Yeah.
Not at all.
The care that goes into these desserts are awesome.
Yeah. Honestly, look, we all love desserts at Disney because
it's Disney and the calories don't count.
Yeah, they don't count. The Disney desserts at Sanaa, at Chico, at Boma are probably some of the best on property. I love the lava cake, but dude, let's get serious. These are the best.
Now we have one more thing to go over real quick, and they actually have a specialty lunch here. And that's
really?
Yes, they have a dine with animal specialist lunch. And basically what this is you'll have a four-course lunch at Sanaa, and you actually get to sit down with one of the caretakers of the animals.
That's cool.
Yeah.
I wanted to do this.
And it's supposed to be one of the most amazing things. We keep on trying to do this, and we never get around to doing it. It does sell out quickly. I want to say they only seat 12 total.
That's exclusive.
I mean, there's no set price for this, so it depends on what you order, I assume.
Yeah.
And it's between $35 and $59.99.
But, so $59, even at the most price, $59 plus tip and tax, and then you get to dine with an animal caretaker. It's not a bad experience.
And I want to say you get up close with the tortoises, reticular, is that right? Is that how you say it? The tortoises, which is pretty awesome. But, I mean, you learn about the animal care, the field research that Disney does, and the role in depth more about the conservation efforts that Disney actually does as well.
Honestly, that would be a fun experience. Like, if you're going to do one of those Dine with the Imagineers, you get to go to the parks. The parks food is...
It depends on which one.
It depends, but the park's food is not nearly as good as most of the resorts.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So, I bet Joe Rohde gets a good meal.
Well, Joe Rohde dines at Chico and Sanaa most of the time. So Joe, like we said, Joe Rohde was instrumental in the creation of this.
Well, that's where he stays when he's on.
He stays here.
I meant when he has his dinner with an Imagineer thing, and it's at Tiffin's.
Yeah, but well, you have to be careful with that.
That's different, though. That's not a dinner. That's like a whole...
Yeah, that's his baby.
Just saying.
Tiffin's, but that's like a whole, he gets up, he gives a speech. This is where he would eat by himself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, look, with any Disney night, we have to end our night with a nightcap, and we wanted to kind of talk about probably one of the best bars in most of the Disney resorts, and that's the Victoria Falls Lounge over at Animal Kingdom Lodge.
Love this lounge.
It's a beautiful lounge with a beautiful scenery, the waterfall. You're on the half floor. You've got a great view of the savannah.
It's relaxing.
It is.
It is super relaxing. And you wouldn't think it is because of the location.
Because it's got like a half floor.
Yeah.
It's a half floor, and it's right off the main entrance, the lobby, and you think all this action's going on there. It's really quiet, surprisingly quiet.
You would think that because you're in a busy hotel, like Misner's, again, right now Misner's is in the middle of the lobby, but even when Misner's wasn't in the middle of the lobby, there was a big band playing. It does get loud.
Mm-hmm.
The Bellevue Lounge, quieter. The Tambu Lounge, very loud.
Yes, extremely.
I think this has a lot to do with, because it's in between floors, it kind of shelters you from that lobby noise. It shelters you from the noise below from Chico and Boma. And it's a small back bar. I mean, it's really not a big bar at all. So it's very intimate. And I think that's where the quietness and the comfortness comes from.
So, the Victoria
Some
Falls.
Drinks you can get here. You got a barrel-aged Manhattan. And this is Bain's Cape Mountain Whiskey.
Which we did, we tasted that on BSEA.
Yes. The Antica Carpano Sweet Vermouth. You have Angostura Bitters, and it's aged for 20 days in a Bain's Cape Mountain Whiskey Barrel.
Yeah, so they take these little barrels and they age that for 20 days. How is that, Tim?
It's really good. We had a lot of them before our last Chico reservation. Made a few. And like I said, we made friends with the bartender, and you know, they were.
You just
got
to talk to them.
I mean, this is the place where you get away from the traditional bar menu. And look, they still have the same menu.
I mean. They have a lot of the Disney drinks. Yes. They have the smoked turkey here.
Right.
They have
Moscow Mule.
Yeah, I mean, they have a lot of basic Disney drinks, but they also have something called the Flame Lily, which is Kirkland Gin, Campari, Vandahum Tangerine Liquor, which is that African liquor again, lemon juice served with a souvenir Lotus Glow Club.
I want that Campari. Look, you guys, now that we don't have someone to critique me on this, I love that Campari bitter.
It's
Beverly
very bitter,
taste.
But it's awesome.
Yeah, it tastes like Beverly, and when you combine that with gin, I'll gladly have that. It's really good.
I think you, Adam, you also had the first time you had a smoked turkey was here.
This
too.
Was my first smoked turkey.
It's a good drink.
It's a decent drink. I really enjoyed it.
From the standard bar menu, the smoked turkey is probably one of the better drinks on property.
And I mean, I think the last interesting drink that they have here is the Seychelles Martini. And
ooh,
that's Kirkland Gin, raspberry liqueur, and pineapple juice over in the souvenir Lotus Glow Cube. So again, this is going to be a super sweet drink.
Yeah.
But it's sticking to a gin martini instead of a vodka, which is kind of interesting because when you have most of these specialty martinis, they're mostly made with vodka or liqueurs.
But Adam, you and I both know a martini is only served with what liqueur?
Oh yeah, it's not a liqueur; it's just vodka.
Well, no, it's gin.
I mean, it's gin. I'm sorry, but it's gin and olives,
mm-hmm.
and vermouth, if you like that kind of thing.
Well, in my case, it is
it's white vermouth.
In my case, it's 3 measures of Gordon's, 1 of vodka, 1/2 measure of Kinalele. Shake over ice until cold, and then serve with a thin, large slice of lemon.
Not a martini, that's a cocktail.
No, that's a Vesper.
That's a cocktail.
It's the best.
All right, Mr. Bond, let's move
it's
on.
The best.
And it's still a cocktail. Anytime you have to add more than 1 alcohol, it's still a cocktail.
Now, so. if you're not into cocktails, they do have a great selection of beer here.
It's really not as extensive as it used to be.
Mm-mm. They do have some African beers with the Casablanca.
They had Casablanca and 1 other one that I can't remember.
Tusker.
Off the top of my head. That was it. Tusker. That's it.
But they're on draft.
Everything else.
At least
but everything else is basic.
Yeah, Corona, Yingling, Bud Light.
Yeah, there's nothing that really interesting.
Now they do have a bottle beer from Castle Lager, I think, or Castle Brewery in South Africa, that's not available anywhere else. This is the only place it's available on Disney property. It's pretty good.
Do you know what? If I'm going to Victoria Falls, I'm not going to go for beer.
Well, but there are some people that are beer people and they only drink beer.
Yeah.
And if you want to be adventurous, definitely try the Castle Lager. The Tusker Lager is really, really good. I like the Casablanca. I've talked about it before. That's Brant's walking beer. It's got a little banana to it. But yeah, if you're sitting down for a drink at a lounge, you're going with a cocktail.
I'm going with a cocktail. I'm going to talk to the bartender.
Yeah.
I'm going to pick their brain and see what they recommend.
Now, you can also get Bain's Neat here, which, again, Tim and Adam, you tasted that on BSEA.
Yeah, we bought a bottle after that.
It's it is.
It's so good.
Really good.
It is
good.
Very good.
Surprisingly good for a 100% corn South African whiskey.
Yeah, I have to try to find up another bottle to bring to BSB.
I've never seen a bottle in the wild. Never.
No, I have.
Where?
I bought down in Allentown.
Well, next time you go there.
Yeah.
pick me up one.
I'll probably
too.
Be down there in the next 2 weeks
there
or so.
There you go. Because it's a really, it's not overly priced. It is not.
Strasburg had it too.
Overly
Strasburg
exclusive.
Strasburg had it at one point.
But it's really, really good. And again, wine flights also. Plenty of white wines, red wines here from South Africa.
Not as extensive.
No, not as Sanaa.
As Sanaa. The Sanaa is the place where you should kind of head to if you're heading, if you're trying to get a wine flight.
Yeah, they have like, what, 5 or 6 different wine flights, and then Victoria Falls has 2 or 3.
But
you can't get Black Pearl at Victoria Falls.
Black Pearl, Camberley,
but you're better off buying it in the store right there.
Yeah.
You can buy a bottle at Zawadi for like $20,
and a flight is $17.
No, a glass is what, $11?
$11 or $12. Yeah.
Yeah, it's $11.
Just go to Zawadi and buy a bottle.
Yep.
And screw caps. So you don't need a
nope. But if you do need glasses, just call up Bell Services. They'll bring glasses.
Yeah, if you're in a DVC room.
Yeah, they will. Takes you 20 minutes to get there, but they'll bring it.
Quick question. On the Banes, how much should that be?
The Banes should probably run you about $15 for a 2 ounce pour. Is it?
No, for a bottle. No, for a bottle.
Oh, for a bottle? 40? 41, yeah. 42?
I think the last I paid was like
Banes Cape Mountain Whiskey.
Yeah.
$34.
Yeah, that's what I paid.
Really?
It was like $35.
Yeah, online.
I thought it was like 40-ish.
No, it was cheaper here.
Okay. So, yeah, Banes should be about 35 for a bottle. If you're at Disney, it's probably going to run you from 12 to 15.
A pour. It's worth it. It's really good.
It's really good. It's a good departure from
that
American whiskey.
Barrel-aged Manhattan at Victoria Falls.
What does that run you?
$15, something like that.
Oh, that's
15
totally
to 17
worth,
bucks.
That's totally
like
worth
that.
It. Totally worth it because the smoked turkey, very good. $12. I'll get a custom crafted cocktail for $15 any day.
And they use Xardos.
Mm-hmm.
And they use your fancy vermouth, Tim.
Yeah, and Tiki Campari. I always have a bottle of that in my fridge.
Yeah. All right. So look, great view of the. Animal Kingdom Lodge. Again, like we said earlier, it's a wonderful departure from Florida. It really does transport you away from Florida. The savannas, now there are 3 11-acre savannas that you can get a view of. I would say that, and I think Tim, Adam, and Mikey would definitely agree with me, if you're staying there, splurge for the savanna view because it's just going to make your experience that much better.
Yeah, I agree. Definitely agree totally. With that.
Now, you can take the chance and buy the regular room, not the value room. The value room is definitely going to be a view of the parking lot. But you can buy a view of the regular room. You can maybe take a chance and get a glimpse of the savanna. But I would recommend buying the savanna view room because it's just worth that price.
I definitely agree.
I mean, elsewhere across Disney property, would you pay for the premium room or the Lakeview room? Well,
it's funny. Before we were DVC, we did.
No, what we used to do is paid for the preferred rooms. The reason why we used to pay for the preferred rooms is because they were closer to all the
main
stuff.
Building.
Right.
It's not necessarily the rooms with the view, but the rooms that were just closer to the buses, closer to the main houses,
right.
All that.
But this is literally one of the best places to upgrade for that view.
Yeah. And I mean, we've gotten lucky every time we've stayed at Animal Kingdom Lodge, and if we didn't book the Savannah View, we've gotten blessed to be upgraded to the Savannah View.
Yeah, shit.
We checked in.
Yeah, shit. You two named a giraffe.
Oh, no, he didn't name a giraffe.
I know,
ostrich.
It was an ostrich.
Ostrich.
It was an ostrich.
That's but, what it was.
It was George. And he greeted me every morning when I was having my chocolate milk on our patio.
Chocolate fucking milk.
And Adam, yeah, no. Adam, is there any other better way to wake up than coffee on the savannah?
Oh, there's no doubt. But the other thing is that some of your technically non-Savannah view rooms actually still overlook the Savannah. Mm-hmm. They may have a partial view.
Yeah.
Like our last room.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You can't call it
a Savannah room because of the angle that the room is actually situated at. But you can still see everything.
15 degrees of our view was a wall, and then the rest was Savannah. Mm-hmm. They couldn't call it Savannah.
Right, but would you make sure you upgrade? Is this one where you would make sure you upgrade to the Savannah view?
Absolutely.
Yeah, because, and you also have to understand, it is far away. It's out of the way for most of your resort. It's most of, like, the Magic Kingdom. It's out of the way for Epcot. It's not too far from the water parks. But, I mean, if this was a splurge, it's, for DVC, it's one of the least amount of points you can use for a resort. So upgrade if you can.
Yeah. And again, if you're going down with like no kids and you're not planning on hitting up Magic Kingdom more than like once on your trip, because Magic Kingdom is what, 30 to 35 minutes away?
No, like, it's not that bad.
No, it's not that bad.
On a bus? Like,
it's about 20.
Like door to door.
About
20.
About 20.
Okay, so it's still a pretty decent trip to get to Magic Kingdom. But if you're going to spend some time with just you and your loved one, and it's kind of a splurge trip, this is definitely one you want to do. I would highly recommend Animal Kingdom.
I love this resort.
So do I. It's my second favorite on property.
Yeah, so check it out if you've got your experience from Animal Kingdom Lodge, if you've had fun there, if you have enjoyed your time there, share it on our Facebook group, facebook.com/groups/3sheets, and make sure you're not going to have a bad time.
Maji Pool Bar.
You're not going to have a bad time at Animal Kingdom.
And some of the best cast member experiences ever had were at
Animal Kingdom Lodge.
Yep. We sat at the rocking chairs overlooking the Savannah one time, and a cast member came up to us, and he was from Zimbabwe, and we sat and had about a 2-hour conversation with this guy. He was telling us all about the troubles that his country was having and why he was here trying to make it better for his country in Zimbabwe, and it was amazing.
That's cool.
I want a job where I can do that for 2 hours.
It was awesome.
It was amazing.
That's he told awesome. Us about the animal sanctuaries. It was just a great conversation that we had.
That's really cool. And again, the cast members here are phenomenal. They are really great people.
Said it again, and I'm out of people.
I know.
Yeah, that's true.
even our server at Jico, when we were in the wine room, he was from Morocco. I forgot his name. I have it written down somewhere, but it was amazing. He was amazing. He recommended every dish we had. The bottle of wine he recommended.
He let us taste the wine, and it was the last bit in that particular bottle, so we got a pretty big taste.
Well, like I said.
And you know, normally you think, you know, they're going to recommend the most expensive bottle of wine, but this wasn't. This was the bottle of wine that he said, this is my favorite, especially with what you're eating. This is what I would go with.
And that is a better experience because they tell you how they feel, how they know about the wines, and they're not just trying to upsell you.
Right.
Correct.
Yeah. Well, look, definitely go check out our Facebook group and share your stories of Animal Kingdom because we love to hear what you guys think about what we do on each show. We love to hear your stories of experience in the parks. And again, Animal Kingdom is such a beautiful resort. I love every time walking through those front doors in Jambo House and looking at that lobby. It just transports you. It really does. Love it. I want to thank you all for joining us this week on Three Sheets the Mouse. If you enjoyed the show, please go over to iTunes, rate, review, subscribe. It's the best way for anyone like you who loves Disney to go find the show and just really engage other people that don't know about the show, that don't know about the Facebook group, to join, to listen, to experience sheeterdom. Is that a word?
It is now.
It is now. Hashtag shooterdom.
And that would be Scott Grammer, ladies and gentlemen.
To experience cheaterdom. And,
can we call it Shinglish for cheater English?
Yeah. Shinglish.
Shinglish.
And just really experience what it is to be part of Three Sheets Nation. So you can also follow us on Instagram and Twitter. We're at Three Sheets Podcast. If you're in the parks, tag us on Instagram. Tag us on Twitter. Put us on your stories. We love to see those. We love to see you in the parks. And we love to make sure that you're having a good time. So come hang out with us over at facebook.com/groups/threesheets. That's where the Three Sheets Nation is where it is. That's the best place to become part of Three Sheets Nation. It's the best place to become a sheeter.
It's the only place to become a sheeter.
Yeah. You can be a sheeter just by listening.
True. Yeah, but that's basically the hub.
Boring.
Yeah, you're like a mild sheeter at that point.
You're a sheeter by name only.
But join the Facebook group, facebook.com/group/threesheets. And Mikey, what do they need to do in order to get into that gateway?
You know, whether you have requested or you decided, hey, I know somebody and I'm going to request on their behalf, make sure that the questions get answered. You know, we don't ask much. Don't be a dick. Answer three questions. That's basically the rules.
Scroll down too. I mean, you see the first
one. Not one, not two.
Yeah.
All three.
Yeah, you see the first one, answer it. Scroll down or, you know, thumb up on your iPhone and answer the other two. So look, as we finish tonight's show, Animal Kingdom Lodge is very near and dear to all of our hearts. We've been there. We love it. Mikey wants to stay there?
Sure.
Mikey, I think you would get a kick out of this place.
I mostly just want to eat there.
You want to eat zebra?
I see that.
It's not like eat zebra. I mean, I imagine it tastes like horse, which I cannot recommend to anybody.
Because you've had it?
Maybe it's the breed, but Palomino's a no-go.
Yeah.
Shetland is pretty tender, though.
Well, it's a pony.
I know, right?
That's like the veal.
Yeah. Horses.
As we approach Big Summer Blowout, we decided that this is time to get the sheeters involved. And we have chosen... Now, we've done this before, but with every sheet up, there comes a time to give back. So with this give back, we wanted to partner with Shelter to Soldier. It's a wonderful charity. We've done this in the past with other charities, but we wanted to partner with this charity where they are going to essentially give back to both post 9/11 veterans and animals that need homes. So this organization is all about giving a post 9/11 soldier with local shelters, local animal shelters, to provide psychiatric service dogs for these combat veterans suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, traumatic brain injury, and other injuries associated with their service. And it's a wonderful organization. I implore you to go to www.sheltertosoldier.org. Check out their mission statement. Check out their About Us page. We are hoping to give back to them. So what we wanted to do was similar to what we did last sheet up, in that you will go to their website, donate, send us your screenshot of your donation, and for $10 per entry fee, we are going to enter you into a giveaway for an awesome prize package. Now, Mikey, your Bermudan artisan is hard at work. It is a sweatshop there.
He was drinking free beer tonight, but yeah. Yeah. Like any Bermudan, he was... You're right, Scott.
Oh, my God.
He's working hard. He's going to be working hard to provide two awesome prize packages. So if you are attending the sheet up, that is awesome. You will be entered into a prize package for this awesome giveaway. So if you're not attending the sheet up, You will also, you can also enter into a prize package. So what we encourage you to do is go over to www.sheltertosoldier.org, and there's a big giant red button at the top right corner of the page that says get involved, donate. And you can donate directly to them. For every $10 you donate, screenshot that donation, send it to us at 3sheetsthemouse@gmail.com. There we'll take your donation. Let us know whether you're entering into the non-BSB attendance giveaway or the BSB attendance giveaway. And those that go to the BSB will be entered into their own prize drawing for the on-site giveaway, and those that don't attend BSB will have their own giveaway as well.
Scott, you used a whole lot of words. I want to try to simplify it just a scotch. If I can.
Mikey, I'm a lawyer. I use words to talk.
Yes, you
most
do.
People, you and, do and, use and, words yeah, to
that,
talk.
That's a prerequisite.
I think that's how that works.
Shelter to... the website is sheltertosoldier.org. Yes? Okay. Correct. That's where you got to go. Click the button, make a donation. You should get a confirmation email of your donation. We want to see that. We want to see... the you know that it went through, not just you typed a number into a blank. All right, some of y'all shady some bitches out there trying to get a free glass, we ain't having it. Also, just to be clear, both prize packages will be the same. So unlike last year where one had a ticket to a special event that we were attending, now this is just going to be for stuffs and goods. So they will both be the same. If you're going to be at Big Smell Blowout and you want to have a chance at picking your prize package up while you're attending, notate that with BSB when you email us the confirmation of your donation. If you are not going to be attending, just say, not going to be there, something to that effect. I mean, if surely to God, you can make it where we can figure it out because, you know, it's all for a good cause.
It really is.
There you go. I don't know if I used any fewer words.
Didn't sound like it.
I just wanted to make sure that everybody was aware we're looking at the same prize package, just do you want to take it home with you and receive it on Facebook Live while you're drunk, or do you not? But yes, we would like you to open it up on Facebook Live while you're drunk.
Well, I mean, the one thing is, if there's something that we can autograph at BSB, we can
say,
definitely
one
sign
might have
some
autographs.
Stuff.
Oh, I will sign anything you put in front of my mouth. Face.
Me too. Wait, what?
Just let it go.
What?
Let it go. Let it go.
Yeah, so if you're going to be attending BSB, make sure you go over to our email, 3sheetsthemouse@gmail.com, and enter
the number 3.
The number 3, yeah, that's right. The number 3sheetsthemouse@gmail.com, and that's where you can send your donation. If you're going to be attending there, make sure you tell us that you're going to be attending and you want to enter into the attendance prize at BSB. If you don't want to enter in the attendance prize, make sure you're on the off-site prize. So tell us in your email so we can make sure that you get into the to the right raffle. I promise you the raffle is going to be worth your time. It's going to be a lot of fun.
And every $10 gets you one entry.
Yeah, $10 per one entry. So if you donate $10, you get one entry. If you donate $100, you get 10 entries.
The more you enter, the bigger your chances
that's
are.
That's right. Is that Scott math enough for you guys?
That's like real math.
That's real math. All right. So as we finish up tonight's show, finish up the business.
By the time this episode drops, there is going to be several new shirts over there at themagicalmeltdown.com.net/teepublic.org. Be sure and check those out, because if you're going to Big Summer Blowout, I'd hate for you to show up underdressed, if you know what I mean.
Oh, yeah. You know what? This t-shirt says, it's formal, but I'm here to party.
I don't think it says anything about that. I'm pretty sure it just says, I'm here to fuck shit up.
And take names.
Nope. Anonymous.
Yeah, definitely go over to our merch site. It's www.themagicalmeltdown.net. You can't buy Scentsy there, but you can buy great t-shirts and great glass. Adam, give me some closing remarks.
For those of you attending BSB, we still have the poll up, so please make sure you vote on who you want for your prom court.
When does that end?
It'll be the Monday of the last week of August. I don't have the date on me, just in case we have to have a runoff or not.
The last day for that is August 30th.
It's not August 30th.
September 2nd.
No,
it was before that.
26th?
Before that. It's the last full week of August.
Okay, so the last day for you to go over to our event page, it's on the Facebook group. Go to the event page. You can check it out and search their BSB prom.
August 23rd will be our last day to vote people into the court. In the event of a runoff, it'll be held the week of the 26th to the 30th so that we can post the main voting beginning September 2nd, Labor Day.
There you go.
But that's the only vote that goes into the main page, because now it's only in the BSB.
Correct. So yes. Only BSB only people who are confirmed attending as BSB attendees are available to vote on the court. It will be uploaded around the 2nd to the voting, who is the four men, four women who are up for king and queen.
Perfect. All right. I like that. And I'm excited.
And then I have one more thing to say. Last but not least, a lot of craziness has been happening lately with everyone and everything and what's been going on in the world. And I kind of found this thing from Kevin Smith. He posted it on Sunday-ish. And it's basically about creativity. And it basically just states, please create something today. Create something positive. Create on behalf of all the people killed in the last few hours, robbed of their chance to ever create again. Create because you might help someone to get through all of this discretion with your creation. Just create, please. And everybody here has gone through some sort of hard time, whether it's music, whether it's listening to us create this podcast for you. We are all capable of creating things. The opposite of war is not peace. It's actually creation. So just get out there, do your best, create what you can for everybody who can.
Can we ask people to share things they created?
Yes. Yeah. Please share things that you created in the group.
Fill the page with some personal joy.
Yeah, definitely. If you've created something Disney that you love, if it's a painting, if it's a sketch, if it's a Mickey ears that you make at home, if it's a drink that you make at home, if it's a Disney drink you make at home, share it. Share your creativity. I love that. Love that, Adam. Tim.
How the fuck am I going to follow that?
Yeah.
You suck.
Try preempting it, Tim.
Hey. Tim, you married the guy.
I know. So, I want to say, first off, I drank this Allagash interlude, and I'm still alive, and I'm not super wasted, which I don't know why they said I was going to be super wasted. Joke's on you, unless it was slow-acting poison. New England ex-murderers.
I'll check in on you tomorrow.
Second thing, one pro tip for staying at Emigrant Lodge, if you pull up in your own car, be careful when you open your trunk that you don't drop your case of Coronitas out of the back. Right. And last but not least, you know that since Three Sheets was founded, we do charity work all the time, and this one is no exception. It's near and dear to all of us. Do this for us. You talk about how we do for you all the time with the show, but do this for us. Donate. Give the charity the monies, and everybody works out.
Yeah.
Everybody wins.
It's a wonderful charity. It involves animals and veterans, and how can you not love both?
Some veterans, like Chris Trossel, I mean. Well. I had to do it. Sorry, Chris. I had to do it.
We love you, Chris.
I thought he was the suggestion,
so I had to throw your name in there.
Yeah.
One way or the other.
He's a big dumb animal, folks. All right, look, I want to thank you guys for listening to the show. It is a pleasure that we do this each and every week. And thank you for going over to our Facebook group and joining. Thank you for rating, reviewing, subscribing. But most of all, we do this once in a while where we do donate, like Tim said. Thank you for those that do reach out of your own pocket to donate to causes that are near and dear to our hearts, that are a part of our show. So I want to thank you from all of us here at Three Sheets of the Mouse. Thank you for making our show part of your Disney life. Thank you for your time this time. And until next time, so long for just a while.